This video is all about the 27 amendments that you need to know for the Constitution test, the worksheet that's due this at the end of like the fifth week before the end of the year, and also the quiz that you're going to take over this unit, which I believe is on 4:30. So you got a lot here. So 27 amendments, we're breaking them in parts. First part, Bill of Rights, first 10 amendments to the Constitution. These were there to protect us, individual rights, to protect us, and make also the Anti-Federalists jump on board. Because the Anti-Federalists were not going to sign on to the Constitution without these. Keep that in mind. So the first one, it's got a lot. It's freedom of speech, petition, assembly, religion, press. It's all good stuff. And here's the thing. These amendments, especially this first batch here, has to do directly what was going on with the colonists when they came over here, either the oppression they felt from the countries they came from or the oppression they felt from Britain themselves. So freedom of speech, being able to say your beliefs, be able to shout your beliefs, but there are restrictions. There's restrictions on all of these amendments. Like, for instance, if I threaten somebody, that's not freedom of speech because that could cause harm to that person. If I say something that is not correct about somebody just to make them look bad, that's also wrong. I'm not protected under freedom of speech. If my speech impacts somebody negatively, there could be repercussions. So there are restrictions to this. Freedom of religion, or in other words, you can't have a state-sponsored religion, in other words, separation of church and state within the Constitution. Press, being able to actually videotape, or not videotape, because they didn't have videotapes back then, but to be able to write down or be able to record or be able to take information from public figures or just people in general or the world around you and be able to print that for other people to see, freedom of the press. Petition and assembly, this is our ability to like get our voices heard for people that, I don't know, really matter, the people that make the laws. It's important for that. All right, Second Amendment, right to bear arms. Obviously, this has to do with guns, gun ownership, owning things to protect one's family and oneself. And this is an important thing idea because this is the idea of what was going on to the colonists by the British. And a lot of it actually had to do with the militia part of the Second Amendment. We'll read the amendment in its entirety because it's like the shortest one. But it's also this idea of arming a militia. And the reason why that's incorporated is because militias back then had usually a warehouse or a storage house of arms, guns that were manufactured at the same by the same company, and they could fit the same type of musket round. And the reason why that's important is because if you're battling another army, and you need to make sure that your weapons are compatible with each other. So if Johnny over here gets shot, I can take his ammo and it's going to work for my gun as if my ammo is also going to work for his gun. It's stuff like that. But this is right to bear arms, own a gun. Three, quarter troops. That means you don't have to have troops stationed in your house and feed them and give them, you know, a place to live. You don't have to do that anymore. We had to do that with the British and we're like, we're not doing that again. All right. Amendment four. It protects you against illegal search and seizure. If I am sitting in my car just enjoying some music, police officer can't stop by my car and say, I'm going to search your vehicle. Unless there is some sort of sign of a crime that took place. So if I'm sitting in my car listening to music and there's nothing else going on, without a warrant, you can't search my property. However, if I have blood all over my body and I'm holding a knife, he can search my car. Like, or if I am literally doing drugs or he can see drugs in my car, he can search my car. That's something that if you can see it, you can search it. Now, that there's limits to this too, especially when it comes to the house. You can't just like constantly search around the entire house, like around the entire house. Oh, I found something. Like, there are limits to this. You have to have a warrant in order to search. Protects us from that. You'd see that this particular amendment is infringed upon, if you will, or there's restrictions on it when you go to the airport. Your stuff is searched and seized and you did nothing wrong, but that pertains to the safety of the people going onto the aircrafts. That's why. Number five is, I always say, don't incriminate yourself. I plead the fifth. It's you do not have to bear witness to yourself. You don't have to testify against yourself. You could just say, I plead the fifth and say I don't want to testify. It's also this double jeopardy increment in here, which is important. You cannot be brought to court for the same crime twice without additional evidence being provided if you are found not guilty for said crime. And we talked about this in class with a few different cases. All right, number six, right to a speedy trial. You can't just get locked into like judicial limbo. You have a right to a speedy trial, so you're not going to be like, okay, I was charged for murder and they're going to have my court date in 10 years. Well, in that time, if I'm not allowed to get out on bail, I am locked away for 10 years until my court. What if I'm not guilty of the crime? So speedy trial, good stuff. Trial by jury is your next one. That is Amendment 7. This is allowing you to be tried by a jury of your peers. This goes into the idea that it shouldn't just be people that are in the court system that should be trying you. It should be the average person. And you have the right to opt out of this and have a trial by just the judge itself. But you do have a right by trial by jury. And then you have also during this time where like the prosecutor and the defense attorney is going to actually work with to figure out what's the best group of jury members that fits both teams in the circumstances that you're in. Number 8 is no excessive bail or punishment. So you can't, if I committed a crime and if I wanted to get bailed out, which basically get out of jail until the court date, they can't set my bail to like $10 million just to keep me in prison. there's bail set for specific crimes. Also, cruel and unusual punishment, they can't like beat me for doing something or like slowly kill me. Like that's why we have different rules about executions. We have different rules about in a way prisons work today. The next two are kind of strange. So 9 is this idea of other rights. Just because the Constitution doesn't give you a specific right written out by word by word, there are rights that are still protected within the Constitution that aren't directly mentioned, like the right to privacy. So there are other rights not mentioned in the Constitution that this amendment says are you're still protected by. And then number 10, states' rights is the idea that states have specific rights that the federal government can't override. And it's just to protect each individual state based on their needs for their individual state. So those are the first 10 Bill of Rights. We're going to hit back with 11 through 20. I got done doing Bill of Rights, which is 1 through 10 of the amendments. Let's get through 11 through 20, which these should be easy for you, except for like maybe 2. There's 2 that I'd be like, all right, I give it to you if you don't know these. So 11 has to do with federal courts. It's establishing, Amendment 11 is establishing like the power differential between like local, state, and federal courts. Now federal courts are kind of like the last line, if you will, leading up to the Supreme Court. Then 12 is, I always think of 1, but actually you're voting for 2, and that probably doesn't help you out at all, but it's the president and vice president are on the same ticket. So you have a Democratic Party, a Republican Party, Independent Party, whatever, that has a presidential nominee and a vice president nominee on the same ticket. So in this case, you were either voting for Mike Pence and as vice president and Donald Trump as president, or Joe Biden and Kamala Harris as the Democratic ticket. You vote for them on the same ticket. 13th, free the slaves. 14th, if you're born here, you're an American. You get all assistance thereof if you're born here in America. 15th, all men can vote, regardless of race. Again, women aren't going to get that for a little while, and there's a Native American clause in here, but all men can vote, regardless of race. That's what you should know for 15th. 16th, income tax. It establishes the income tax that it basically says can be proportional to one's income, and they can tax you on the income that you make from your employer. 17th Amendment is vote for senators. Before, you didn't vote for senators. This was done within the states themselves, usually through a legislative process, or through the legislator. But now we can vote for senators, and we vote for them every 6 years, and we'll talk about that later when we get to the legislative branch. 18 is you can't drink alcohol. Think about it this way. 18 is you cannot drink alcohol when you're 18 years old, okay? The 18th Amendment, prohibition, gets rid of the ability to drink alcohol for the entire country. So remember that, 18th, no alcohol. 19th, women finally get their say. They can vote in the 19th Amendment. And finally, 20th, think of the lame duck. It's the only one with an animal that you have to remember. So the lame duck is the session between when we vote for the president in November and when they take office at the end of January. It shortened it because before that, it was like all the way up to March. So it shortened it shortened that section of you were voted out here, you're going to take office here, and it shortened it so we get that new president or new elected official, and they're not sitting there in the lame duck session. Let's get to the last few, 21 through 27, and we're done. Batch, this is it. The last one, 20 through 27. This is all the amendments that you need to know. All of them, you need to know all of them, but this is it. So the first one, 21, is you can't drink alcohol when you're 18. That's why prohibition took place during the 18th Amendment. Wonderful coincidence. The 21st Amendment, you can drink alcohol when you're 21. And as the 21st Amendment states, no more prohibition. We can get that alcohol again. So 21 ends prohibition. We can now buy and sell alcohol once again. 22, I always think of this, 22, two terms. Okay, president can only run for 2 terms of office. We know that FDR, he actually won 4 terms. He died in his 4th term, like, I don't know, like 70 or 80 days in his 4th term. But it's two terms, that's it, done deal, that's all you can do that for. So two terms, 22. Then we have 23, D.C. can vote for president. So they actually have electoral points for D.C. But keep in mind, as of this video, there's a law that, or not a law, there is H.R. 51, I can't think of the exact number, that was just passed in the House that is trying to make D.C. a state. But as of right now, all they can do is vote for president, but they have no representation whatsoever in Congress. You can say that they have Mrs. Norton, who is the House member for D.C., but she can't vote. So I don't see what the point is of having somebody there that can't vote. We had the same thing with Britain, by the way. We had Benjamin Franklin over in England at the time as a representative, but he couldn't vote for anything. So it's the same deal as that. So yeah, right now, D.C., for number 23, they can vote for president, but they don't have any kind of representation for lawmaking, which is kind of the big deal. 24 is no poll tax. You do not have to pay money to vote. That's a big no-no. That was something that was done during Jim Crow in the South for African Americans. Two African Americans to keep them from voting, and this is a way to protect people's voting rights, and they don't have to pay poll tax. 25 is the president is unable to do his job or her job. The 25th Amendment can be invoked, and that is basically saying that because the person cannot do their job because of their physical or mental capabilities are not there, they can be removed. So let's say if they get super sick, let's say if they have a stroke, like Woodrow Wilson did, which this was not invoked during his time. Basically, his wife was president-ish during that time. But this is, the president can't do his job for whatever reason. This can be invoked and the vice president takes over. So 26, you're 18 years old. You can vote. That's relatively new when it comes to amendments, but at 18, you can vote. So do it, get educated, vote. And then finally 27 is the most comical in my mind. So 27, there's a little bit more to this, but Congress is allowed to vote for their own pay raises. We'll let that settle in for a second. Now, there are some stipulations to this, is that if they vote for a pay raise, they will not get that pay raise until they're reelected. But since most politicians in Congress get reelected over and over and over and over again, it's true, they have to get reelected again, but the chances of them being reelected is pretty high based on what's happened in the past. But yeah, 27, last amendment of the Constitution is they can vote for the pay raises. I mean, that's awesome. I would love to vote for my own pay raises, but it's just whatever. So that's the 27 amendments. Know them, live them, love them. You got it. All right, let's get to it. Good luck on to the Friday's test/quiz, over the amendments. Make sure you fill out the worksheet. Be ready, be ready, be ready.